Howdy and welcome to the Strange West Podcast. This is your host and word hustler extraordinaire, Trent Tano. Leading us in, as always, with their rendition of Ennio Morricone's For a Few Dollars More, is the mighty Mitch Polzak and the Royal Deuces. If you like your guitar slingers like you like your gunslingers, then head on over to MitchPolzak.com. That's Mitch, B-O-L-Z-A-K.com. And for tonight's podcast, the Cowboys vs. Nazis adventure continues with Chapter 8 of Paris High Noon by yours truly, Trent Tano. You can get a copy today at parishighnoon.com, both paperback and ebook at parishighnoon.com. Paris High Noon t-shirts are available at society6.com/trenttano. Both Paris High Noon t-shirt sweaters as well as mustache t-shirts and sweaters are available at society6.com/trenttano. And as always, thank you to James K. Doyle for lending us his time and talent to the Strange West podcast. He really brings the Paris High Noon to life. Thank you again, James. So without further ado, here is Chapter 8 of Paris High Noon.
Chapter 8, Hole in the Wall. Morning brought a slight chill. Autumn was still a few months away, but coming too quick for men used to city living. "I'm hungry," Quick Billy said, and the rest of the thieves and murderers quickly agreed. Only after going through the harvest sack did they realize that last night's meager meal was a feast compared to what they had to eat this morning. 10 rations of hard biscuits and a few strips of goat meat were all that was left. Quick Billy chipped a tooth on one of the biscuits, prompting the rest of the crew to soak theirs in water. When Catfish walked into the camp, everyone was looking to see if he had any food. "If I had a fishing pole, I might be able to trick some trout out of a stream," Catfish said. "Maybe you could rope another goat," St. Jude suggested to Jean. "Or better yet, a cow," Patrice said. "I'll order up a plate of bacon with poached eggs and a coffee with two sugars," Louis said from his pallet of grass. He then closed his eyes and waited for his order to come. "Well, I'm no waiter, and I don't hear any goats or cows," Catfish said. "Besides, the Boche have probably took all the livestock in the area." At the mention of the Germans, the outlaws' faces went pale. Out there in the Norman countryside, it was almost possible to forget that an empty stomach was the least of their problems. "So, Moses," St. Jude said to Catfish, "where are you going to lead your people this time?" Catfish took a small swig from his flask, smacked his lips. "Oh, I figure we got some more desert between us and the Promised Land. But we'll get there in God's time." St. Jude guffawed, and the rest of the gang became restless. They knew about as much of the Norman countryside as Catfish did. If this were Utah or Wyoming, Catfish would have known exactly where to go. There were so many hidden valleys and canyons that it was easy to hide from the most rabid posse. But this wasn't the Wild West, with its sweeping, endless plains and high plateaus with miles of canyon. Northwest France was home to rolling hills, millennium-old peasant farms, and thin woods. Catfish was finding it harder and harder to locate a proper hideout for his growing band. Hammer cracked his knuckles. The log he sat on sagged into the soft dirt. "We should take over one of these chateaux. Have those rich bastards serve us dinner and scrub our backs." Most of the gang let out a good-natured hurrah. "Fool," St. Jude said. "The Boche bastards are shacked up in these old manors, fucking the mistresses of our brave politicians." "Ah, mistress," Louis said. "Wherever we go, there should be some women." "And some wine," Quick Billy added. "I'll take a feather bed," Jacques said. "Well, boys," Catfish said, "put your hands out and wish in one and piss in the other and see which one fills up first." The gang grumbled and got up from their stupor to begin another long walk all over creation. They would have left the old cowboy and struck to their own trail if they weren't strangers in their own country. But they were men of concrete, glass, and all the accoutrements of city living. As such, They resigned to follow the old cowboy until something better crossed their trail. By noon, the gang had passed over the thin woods of the Bocage country to the rolling, thick forested hills of the Collines du Perchet. Up above, another flock of Luftwaffe bombers droned through the early morning sky on their way to drop their iron eggs on England. The men stopped to rest in the shade, their feet full of blisters and stomachs as empty as their pockets. A pheasant flew above them, followed by a large boom. The gang found themselves peppered by feathers, guts, and blood. Everyone flopped to their bellies, pulling their guns and blades out. Heavy footsteps crunched through the field. A tall, stout man with a double-barreled shotgun walked towards them. He was standing right in the middle of the gang before he realized he wasn't alone. Guns and blades pointed at the man, who calmly picked up the pheasant. "You don't have to kill me if you want the bird," he said in a thick Norman accent. "I'll just go and shoot another one." Catfish got up from his belly. "We ain't gonna gun you down, monsieur, but we'll all feel a lot better if you drop that street cannon of yours." The stranger put his shotgun on the ground and raised his hands. John ran over and struggled to pick up the double-barreled shotgun. The rest of the gang got up, but still kept their guns on the large Norman. "So," Hammer said with a shrug, "should we kill him?" The tall man laughed. "You sure are a bold group of thugs. Can't even decide whether or not to kill an unarmed man." "Your arms are plenty big, friend," St. Jude said. "You could crush us with your thumbs." Catfish smiled and said, "Are you going to stare at each other all day, or are we going to eat this bird?" Patrice got a fire going. Catfish threw the pheasant at Jacques and Louis to clean. "So, stranger, you from around these parts?" Catfish asked. The tall man folded his arms, looking at Jean, who held the shotgun precariously in his arms. "That boy is going to shoot his foot off if he keeps holding my shotgun like that," the stranger said. "If he does, don't blame me." Catfish looked over at John and told him to give the shotgun back to the stranger. "Are you sure that's a good idea?" St. Jude asked. "There's only one shell in the chamber," Catfish replied. "He could club us with those barrels," Hammer said. He was a big man himself, but the Norman made him feel small. The stranger took his shotgun and put it in his lap. "Your cooks are butchering my pheasant," he said with a scowl. "I don't think you appreciate your place at the table, mon ami," Quick Billy said, with the barrel of the submachine gun pointed at the stranger. "What's your name, mister?" Catfish said. "It's bad enough we got off to a rough start. We don't have to keep going with such bad manners." "Barnaby," the Norman said. "Name fits." Catfish patted Barnaby on the back. "You got a house or a barn we can stay in for the night?" "Sure, but you're going to have to share it with the Boche." St. Jude said, "I don't like sharing with my fellow Frenchmen, let alone those damn sons of bitches." "Neither do I, especially pheasants that I shot." Hammer cracked his knuckles. "These Boche friends of yours? They shot one of my milk cows and then took the rest. So I killed one of them. And they started to shoot at me." Barnaby lifted up his shirt to reveal a nasty red wound where a bullet had glanced off his ribs. "They nicked me and killed my plow horse. I've been on the run ever since." Catfish gave a chuckle. "Surviving off pheasants and cabbage, I bet." "Oh, I run across a stray lamb here and there." Barnaby jerked his thumb back across the Norman fields. "Mostly there." "Any deserted chateau you run across?" St. Jude asked. "One more night in the woods and I might turn myself in." "No," Barnaby said. "Mostly bombed out houses and occupied villages. I was hoping to make it to the Swiss border before autumn." "Hey, that's not a bad idea," Hammer said. "Why the hell are we walking into the bedrooms of the Wehrmacht when we could be going to the frontiers like Switzerland or Spain?" "The border is the first place they'll think to look," Catfish said. "I aim to keep heading west." "The only thing you'll find along the way are the swamps," Barnaby said. and if you're not careful, you'll get lost in the dead man's water. What the hell is that? Quick Billy said. Some sort of fucked up swimming hole? The outlaws gave a hesitant laugh. Barnaby said, it's a cursed swamp where the souls of the damned suffer in agony. At night, when the wind blows from the channel, you can hear their wails. I take it it's not a spot where most folks tend to go, Catfish asked. No one goes there. And if they do, they don't come back. Barnaby sat down and leaned the shotgun next to a tree. 50 years ago, a group of schoolgirls went out for a picnic with their teacher. When they didn't return, there was a search. Their tracks went into the dead man's water. Nobody wanted to follow them in there, but a few fathers of the girls did. They waited for them to return for 3 days and finally gave up. I doubt if the Bosch would go there. Sounds like the perfect hideout, Catfish said with a mustache-lifting grin. Hammer put his hands on his hips. Yeah, if you want to hide from the living, I say we go to the border. I know some guys we can hide out with in Leon and then make for Switzerland. All in favor, say aye. A round of ayes went out, but Catfish stayed silent. I guess that settles it, Hammer said, and started to walk in the opposite direction they had been going. Barnaby, Louis, Jacques, and Quick Billy began to follow. The others stood by Catfish, who kept his hand on the butt of his Colt and his eyes on the two bulls. St. Jude got up. What do you mean that settles it, he said. Last time I checked, you weren't the boss of shit. Hammer turned around and faced St. Jude, cupping his left hand over his ear. Did you say something? Because it's hard to hear anything coming out of that cunt mouth of yours. The outlaw squared off, gun hands ready. Catfish pulled out the peacemaker and stepped in between the two. By God, I thought I told you boys to play nice. Now, if the two of you want to blow each other's brains out, go about 5 miles north and have your showdown. Catfish looked at the others. And that goes for the rest of you. Now, I told you boys to do what I say when I say it, and I'm pretty damn sure I didn't tell you to go to the Swiss border. The men watched silently. Catfish held the big Colt in his hand like a gavel. Now, if you want to strike out on your own, that's your business. Me not being around while they slip the noose over your heads is mine. So, get if you're getting. St. Jude and Hammer kept their stares on each other, but each inched his hand away from his gun. The rest turned to one another for a reason to go, but found only empty looks. Barnaby pushed past Louis and Jacques, sitting back down with Jean and Patrice. Hammer stood in front of Louis, Jacques, and Quick Billy. Off in the distance, a dust cloud gathered as another Wehrmacht convoy rolled by. Quick Billy stepped over to Catfish, sitting down with the rest. All's I know is that I'm tired of walking, and it's a long walk to the Swiss border. Soon, Louis and Jacques went back to stand or fall with Catfish. Hammer stood with his hands on his hips while his pride and common sense slugged it out. I can't believe you guys are going to follow this old cowboy into a swamp that kills people. Hammer threw up his hands. It was toothy all over again for the second-class brigand. Anytime he mentioned an idea, Toothy would shoot it down quicker than the old cowboy could pull out his gun. Fine. Let's go get killed. Catfish stopped Hammer as he walked by to join the others. You and me going to have any more problems? Hammer shook his head. Good, Catfish said. I don't have to tell you that in this business you rarely get second chances. Hammer nodded. Catfish twirled the Colt back into the holster. St. Jude was about to say something when Catfish grabbed him by the arm. Just because your enemy falls face first into shit don't mean you got to go out of your way to rub it in. St. Jude held up his hands and bit his tongue. Catfish turned to the rest of the gang. Now, if you girls are done dancing, I say it's about time we get a-going. Barnaby, how far is it to this dead man's water? The edge of the swamp is about a two-day walk from here, Barnaby said. All right, Catfish said. Let's get going. The men walked through the thick woods well into dusk, bumbling into bushes and tripping over roots before Catfish had them strike another cold camp. The gang had a small meal of cabbages and tubers that Patrice and Barnaby were able to forage along the way. The men complained liberally about the accommodations. Each talked about the perfect hideout, and although they disagreed with the details, they all agreed that it should be dry, warm, with big soft beds, a well-stocked wine cellar, and a couple of horses to do the cleaning. Catfish rolled his eyes at the idle talk around the campfire. There were plenty of rough times on the outlaw trail when he wanted a soft bed and an even softer whore. But wanting and being wanted were two different things. About the worst hideout I ever had was a dirty old trapper lean-to in Colorado, he said. It was right after robbing a bank out of Vernal, Utah. All went according to plan until we got out of the bank. I had just saddled up when somebody called my name. It was Big Dan, whose pappy, Old Dan, ran one of the biggest cow outfits east of the Green River. It was also my bad luck that I had an unearned reputation of acting less than a gentleman to Junior's little sister. Big Dan started throwing some choice words at me, and all of a sudden one of the guards we had tied up broke loose and started screaming how we were robbing the bank. Hammer cracked his knuckles and looked over at St. Jude. Reminds me of that Leon job. St. Jude let out a long sigh. Catfish took out his silver flask and took a long pull. Well, I guess that gave Dan the excuse and sand he needed, because the next thing I see are guns being pulled. Good thing Petey McCourt was sober enough to have his sawed-off shotgun ready. He let both barrels fly into Big Dan's crew. We rode out of town, guns blazing, clearing the streets and keeping heads down. Just as we got out of town, someone took a shot and hit my horse. I tumbled pot over kettle while the rest of the boys rode off. Behind me, Big Dan and what was left of his crew were getting ready for a charge. I thought for sure I was going to get perforated when Lee English rode up, reached out his hand, and I swung up onto the backside of his horse. I told Petey McCord and the Hamburg Kid to ride for the relay station and to meet us with fresh horses at the hideout at Robber's Roost. I told Lee to ride with the professor, since Lee's horse was already tired from the extra burden, and go meet Petey and the Hamburg Kid at the hideout. Lee didn't like the idea, but we heard the posse coming and there was no more time to argue. I led that posse high up into the mountains. Snowfall was early that winter. The drifts were so thick I had to get off the horse. It slowed Big Dan and the posse more than it did me, but they eventually caught up. It had been more than 48 hours straight since Big Dan laid eyes on me, and high up in that mountain pass he saw me again for the last time. He yelled my name and told me to go to hell. I turned and saw some of the boys trying to get him to stop, even grabbing his arms. I don't know what possessed him to shout at me, let alone fire off his rifle with that snowpack hanging over our heads. But when I heard the crack of the rifle, I ran as fast as I could. I might as well have tried to outrun the sun. A white wall hit me and I tumbled down. Who knows how far? John's eyes went wide and he leaned close to Catfish, who took another touch of the brown. When I come to, my world was cold and white. My body felt like I got trampled over by 100 pairs of cattle hoofs, but I got my arms and legs to go to work. By the time I poked my head out, the morning sun had just broken over the mountains. The only thing I could see were the tops of the fir trees and an even blanket of snow. I took stock of what I had, my pistol, knife, and matches with some tobacco to go with it. I figured it was another 3 days on foot to get to Robber's Roost. I made good time until on the second day a storm blew off the mountains, catching me out in the open. Luckily, I found an old trapper's lean-to. Then a fever took hold of me. The only thing I could do was shiver under a moldering bearskin and fire off a shot every time the wolves stuck their mouths in. I tell you, boys, it's times like those you wish you had a friend, even if it was only someone to tell you to keep going when you can't say it yourself. Ain't nothing worse than dying alone. The fire popped, little sparks of ember crackled in the night air. Did anyone find you? Sean asked. St. Jude punched his little brother in the shoulder. Of course someone found him, otherwise Catfish wouldn't be dragging us all over creation. Catfish didn't seem to notice the remark. He just stared into the fire. I was going in and out of my head, and I knew it was only going to be a matter of time before the wolves would get wise and jump me. Then, like something out of the Bible, who showed up but Lee English on a fresh horse? When he came across the avalanche, Lee thought the worst. He was about to give up on me when he heard distant pistol shots. The gang waited for Catfish to continue, but the old cowboy just stared ahead. Shadows from the flames moved around his weathered face. Sean put his hand on Catfish's shoulder. You okay? Catfish jerked his head back and looked at John, who was surprised to discover the old cowboy's eyes were misty. That was twice Lee saved my life. Catfish let out a long sigh, looked at the flask, shook his head and put it away. Most of the gang had already dropped off to sleep. St. Jude kept an eye out on the darkness, but his lids were getting heavy. You boys turn in, Catfish said. I'll take the first watch. You want me to stay up with you? Sean said. Catfish shook his head. That's all right, son. I've got plenty of thoughts to keep me company. Sean shrugged and settled into his bedding. The crickets were chirping and the frogs croaking. Catfish let the fire die out. He stayed awake, staring at the coals until dawn. When morning came, the men shook off their slumber, looking like dumb cattle meandering around until they figured out their place in the world. They smelled like cattle, too, as Catfish pointed out. The boys didn't much care for a wash back in Paris and didn't have much of a choice now that they were out in the countryside. For breakfast, they ate what was left over from dinner, which wasn't much. An army marches on their stomachs, Quick Billy said. The army doesn't even march, Hammer said. They just throw up their hands while the Boche stuff kraut in their faces. Again, they were on the move. They made good time and covered lots of ground through the thick woods. Throughout the day, Luftwaffe planes buzzed high above like giant mosquitoes. After a few more miles, they reached the flat, marshy plateau where the Collines du Perchet dropped off into the Sarthe River Valley to the south. Catfish hoped to make it to Dead Man's Water before sunset. Most of the men wanted to rest and get something to eat, but Catfish insisted they keep moving. They grumbled but followed, more afraid of being left alone out in the woods than having to deal with sore feet and hollow stomachs. They made it to the edge of the swamp just before nightfall. A wet wind picked up from the channel. It grew stronger and colder as the gang plodded toward the treeless marsh. They wrapped themselves up as best they could, but the sky cracked open and a summer storm soaked them through. The ground around them grew soggier with each step. The wind and rain picked up. Lonesome wails sounded from the darkness. It's the souls of the damned, Barnaby said. Hammer balked. You want us to go into that purgatory? It's too dangerous to go in at night, Barnaby said. We'll get lost for sure, and our souls will be trapped in this place. Well, if we wait around in the open till daylight, our bodies will be filled with holes, Catfish said. Although he didn't like the looks of the terrain, by going through the swamp now with a storm, they would be able to cover most of their tracks from the last few days. He felt it was worth the risk. We better worry about our souls at a later date, St. Jude said. I think most of us know where they'll end up. The gang entered the swamp. Keeping close on the trail, Catfish had a hard time negotiating the marshes. He'd encountered many a bog and sinkhole during his days on the run, but back then he could just ride around them. This time he was headed straight into thick reeds and soggy ground. About the only thing he could see through the mist was his own hand. A blast of cold air and a haunting howl screeched right by him. The men let fly curses and prayers to both devil and saint. "Sounds like a chimney," Catfish said.
"You mean there's a house in all this gloom?" Quick Billy said.
"No, a natural rock chimney. Out on the Outlaw Trail, there are natural chimneys carved out from wind and rain. Usually it's a sign of a cave or overhang close by. Watch your step, because if you fall in one, it'll be a long drop to the center of nowhere." They continued to walk single file along the trail, knee-deep in muck, following the reeds and clumps of grass. Suddenly a cry and a sucking sound came from the back of the line.
"Catfish!" Sean cried out. "Patrice is sinking!"
Catfish tried to turn back around, but couldn't get around Jacques and Louis, who refused to step off the trail for fear of getting sucked in themselves.
"Quick," Catfish said to Jean, "throw the rope."
Jean struggled to get the rope out. His hands and fingers were too flustered to work. By the time he freed it, Patrice had sunk to his chest. Jean coiled the slack in his left hand and threw the lasso over his head. Patrice was waving his hand like a weather vane in a storm. Jean threw the rope high and the lasso in snagged Patrice's right arm. Jean dug in his heels.
"Everyone grab hold," Catfish yelled.
St. Jude and Barnaby grabbed the rope while Jean slipped around the bank of the trail, trying not to fall into the bog. The muddy rope slipped through their hands. It felt like for every inch they pulled in, they let a yard go. Hammer shoved Quick Billy to the side, grabbed a hold of the rope, and began to pull. Patrice was slowly being pulled out. He had wrapped his free hand around the lasso, and although his hands felt like they were being squeezed and torn apart, he held on. Quick Billy, Jacques, and Louis stood on the path and watched the men pull the rope hand over hand until St. Jude was able to grab Patrice by the arm and pull him in. Patrice winced when Jean unwound the coil from around his palm. An angry, deep purple welt made his fingers curl.
"Boy, we thought you were a goner," Catfish said.
"Me more than you," Patrice replied. They picked him up and carried him onto the dry path.
"Thanks to all of you," Patrice said.
Jean knelt by his side and dressed the wound with a piece of cloth he tore from his shirt. Hammer walked over and clapped his big hand on Patrice's shoulder.
"You had us huffing and puffing, you little shit," he said with a big grin.
"Next time we'll let you sink down and turn into peat." The men had a good laugh at one of them cheating death. All of them had experience at staying one step ahead of the pale horseman.
"Let's move," St. Jude said, "before the devil claims one of us."
Catfish led the way down the trail. By false dawn, the bandits found themselves descending steeply as if they were running away from the sun and into the dark arms of the pit. The trail, if it could be called that, was narrow with tight switchbacks. A few slipped and were saved by grabbing onto the thin trees and shallow roots that barely held. Jean let Patrice lean against him, helping him down the narrow pass. When they hit the bottom, Catfish stopped.
"All right, boys, we're home."
The gang looked around, but dawn had yet to light up the bottom of the pit. The only landmark they could see was a small creek that ran alongside the long, grassy sandbar.
"I don't see anything," St. Jude said.
"That's the point," Catfish said. "This will be the last place in Normandy somebody will think to look for us. And odds are they still won't find us if they do. With a few upgrades, the cliff will make a good refuge while we plan our next move." Jean laid Patrice down on the soft grass. Patrice shivered as the sky cleared and rays of sunlight broke over the horizon.
"Can I light a fire?" Jean asked. Go ahead, but try to use as much dry wood as you can. Let's not push our luck too far. The rest of the gang dropped where they stood. It seemed like everything had hit them at once. The war, the fighting, the running, and the loss of everything they once took for granted. Yet fate had taken them to her teat, and they drank greedily. Sean made the fire near Patrice, who had fallen into a deep sleep, along with the rest of the gang on the soft green grass of France.
And welcome back to the Strange West Podcast. This is your host, Edward Hessler, extraordinaire Trentano. And that about does it for Chapter 8 of Paris High Noon by yours truly, Trentano. And if you want to find out what happens next, you can download a copy of Paris High Noon right now at parishighnoon.com. Download the ebook or put an order in to purchase the paperback at parishighnoon.com. And don't forget, you can also get t-shirts and sweaters at society6.com/Trentano. The Paris High Noon and mustache t-shirts and sweaters at society6.com/Trentano. And leading us out, as always, is the mighty Mitch Polsek and the Royal Deuces doing their rendition of Emo Mariconi's For a Few Dollars More. And thank you for listening, and we'll see you again next week. Till then, take care and happy trails.